Hey everyone, I'm going to go ahead and do some problems that relate to the review for the end of chapter 9. We're not quite done with chapter 9, but I'll go ahead and start doing the practice problems. If there's one that we come across that we haven't covered yet, I'll come back and do that one as a separate tutorial. What I'm going to do is do some of the problems that are at the back of the book. At the back of each chapter, you'll find that there is a quiz that kind of ties together all of the concepts that we've talked about for that chapter. So I'm going to go through most of the questions in your quiz, and then I'm also going to do a couple of selected problems from the end of the chapter. So let's start with question one, and it asks, which pair of elements is most likely to form an ionic bond? Okay, so the strategy that we would use to solve this problem is to think about the difference in their distances where they're located on the periodic table. We know that the types of elements that form ionic bonds, we like to have a metal and a nonmetal. So, which one of these happens to be a metal with a nonmetal? Nitrogen and oxygen, those are both nonmetals. So that's not it. Carbon and hydrogen are also both nonmetals, and so are sulfur and oxygen. However, calcium is a metal, and oxygen is a nonmetal. So therefore, we would expect calcium and oxygen to form an ionic bond when bonded together. And let's go ahead and just, for the sake of practice, do with the Lewis structure for that. So calcium is in group 2 on the periodic table. When we draw the Lewis structure for calcium, we see that we have this configuration, calcium with 2 valence electrons. When we draw the Lewis structure for oxygen, we see that we have 6 valence electrons. And so we said that we want to, when we form an ionic bond, we want to bond the 2 atoms together to where their overall, all of the valence electrons are paired, and the overall charge is neutral, or 0. So we see here that we've got 2 vacant spaces on the oxygen to accept electrons. So we know that in ionic bonding, the electrons are transferred from one atom to the other. So therefore, this is what's going to happen. The calcium is going to give both of its electrons to the oxygen and turn into calcium 2+. Then when oxygen receives those extra electrons, it's going to have a total of 8 valence electrons. And since it's received 2 extra electrons, it's now going to have a charge of -2 or 2-. So therefore, when this 2- charge is attracted to the 2+ charge, we end up having an ionic bond formed. There are no valence electrons left here that are unpaired with the calcium. There are no unpaired valence electrons with the oxygen. In other words, it has a complete octet. It has 8 electrons, so it's happy. So that would be the Lewis structure of the ionic bond that would be formed between the calcium and the oxygen. If we had where this was an ionic bond between sodium and oxygen, then since sodium has 1 valence electron and oxygen needs 2 extra electrons to complete its octet, we would have the situation where we would have two sodium atoms giving up one of their electrons to form the extra to complete the octet for oxygen. Okay, so it would be when we would predict the ionic compound that will form from calcium and oxygen, it would be one calcium and one oxygen. When we would predict the compound that will form from sodium and oxygen, it would be two sodiums and one oxygen. When this sodium gives up its electron, and when that sodium gives up its electron, let me redraw. This is getting sloppy. Okay. So basically, the electron from one of the sodiums will be transferred to one vacant location, and the electron from the other sodium will be transferred to the other vacant location, and therefore you end up with 8 electrons around the oxygen, which means that that's what it wants, and it's now happy. And then you would have a positive charge on each one of the sodium atoms. And an overall negative charge on the oxygen atom. So the two positive charges on the sodium will be attracted to the -2 negative charge on the oxygen, and therefore that's how the ionic bond would form. Okay, so now we want to know which set of elements is arranged in order of increasing electronegativity. So we would need to look at our periodic table. Okay, so when we look at the periodic table and look at the location of each element relative to the other ones, we know that our trend in electronegativity tells us that it increases as we go up a group and across a row. So basically, we would just look at going across a row here, geranium, arsenic, then we start to go up towards sulfur and oxygen. So that would be the relative direction that we would need to follow to rank our elements in order of increasing electronegativity. So geranium is the smallest, followed by arsenic, followed by sulfur, and oxygen has the largest electronegativity value. So basically you just look at the relationship. You look at the region on the periodic table where each element lies relative to the other ones, and you can predict the trend using that strategy. Okay, so which is the correct Lewis structure for magnesium bromide? So let's draw it out. We know that magnesium is in group 2. And it has 2 valence electrons. And that is the Lewis dot configuration for magnesium. We know that bromine is in group 7. And it has 7 valence electrons then. So in order for us to be able to form a compound with magnesium and bromine, we know that magnesium, is a metal. It's on the very left side of the periodic table. And we know that bromine is a nonmetal. So anytime you have a reaction between a metal and a nonmetal, you expect an ionic compound to form. And when an ionic compound forms, it has to do so in a way that makes the overall charge on the compound zero. So magnesium has 2 valence electrons, and bromine is only able to accept 1 valence electron in order to have a complete octet of 8 electrons. So therefore, we have 2 electrons to give up from magnesium. So if each bromine is only able to accept 1 electron, then that means we're going to have an additional bromine to accept that other electron that's coming from magnesium. So therefore, this is what we would end up with. We would end up with magnesium giving up both of his electrons, 1 to 1 bromine, and then 1 to another bromine. Okay, so therefore, since magnesium gave up 2 of them, it's going to have a positive 2 charge. Each bromine then accepted 1 electron. So each bromine then is going to have a -1 charge. So therefore, when you have the +2 from the magnesium, let me erase that. Hold on. I was trying to do a laser pointer there. Okay. So when you have the +2 from magnesium, and then you have 2 negative charges here, the +2 and the -2 end up equaling 0. So therefore, your overall molecule, ionic compound is neutral. So the way this would look would be like that one. Let's see. 1 magnesium, 2 plus, and 2 bromines. That have a -1 charge. Okay, so that's the correct Lewis structure for magnesium bromide. All right. Which compound is likely to have an incomplete octet? Well, we know from our last lecture where we talked about exceptions to the octet rule, we know that we have 3 different exceptions where a atom may not necessarily have to have 8 electrons around it. One of those is a species where we have an odd number of electrons. So the other one was if we have an incomplete octet because there are not enough electrons to go around. And the last one is when we have an expanded octet because we have too many electrons to put someplace. So we said that the elements that are most likely to form incomplete octets are boron, beryllium, and lithium. So incomplete octet is what we're looking for right now. Okay, so the compound here that would be most likely to have an incomplete octet would be the one that contains one of these elements, and that would be D, which contains a boron. This one doesn't have either one of those compounds. I'm sorry, any one of those elements. This one doesn't have either one of those elements, and neither does this one. D actually has one of the elements that we know can form an incomplete octet. Okay, so now which compound has the highest magnitude of lattice energy? I'm not going to go through this one just yet in the tutorial. I will repost a separate video for this one because we haven't covered this in class yet. We're going to cover that on Tuesday. That's the last part of chapter 9. So I will come back and do this one for you at that point. Same thing for this one. Lattice energy we have not covered yet. Which pair of atoms forms the most polar bond? We have covered the concept of bond polarity and electronegativity, but this is also something that we need to cover on Tuesday, so I'll come back and do that one for you as well. And same for that. All right, so which is the correct Lewis structure for nitrogen trifluoride? Well, let's write it out. So we have, first of all, we need to connect our skeleton structure. And we know that each one should have an octet around it. And we know that we need to have the least electronegative element in the middle. And we also know that we need to minimize the formal charge on all of the elements. So let's look at which structure does all of those things. Okay, so we know that based on our rules, nitrogen is not one of those elements that can have an expanded octet. This nitrogen here has more than 8 electrons. So immediately we can rule that one out. We also know that based on our rules, nitrogen is not one of those elements that can have an incomplete octet. Only boron, beryllium, and lithium can have incomplete octets. And in this structure, structure B, nitrogen only has 6 electrons around it when we know it must have 8. Okay, so the other two plausible structures are these two, C and D, where we have all of our elements having the complete octets and having the correct number of electrons in the structure. When we look at the number of electrons that we have to distribute the nitrogen atom, we have one of those and it brings 5 valence electrons, so that gives us a total of 5 electrons. The fluorine, we have 3 of those. It brings 7 valence electrons, so that gives us a total of 21. When we add that together, we get 26. And when we would put together our best guess for a skeleton, we would see that we use 6 electrons in making the skeleton structure with these bonds here. And so therefore, we're left with a total of 20 electrons to put around the remaining atoms. So if we start 2, 4, 6, 8, 12, 14, 16, 18, 20, that is a very plausible structure, and it will be my first guess for the correct Lewis structure for nitrogen trifluoride. The other approach that you could take to make sure that this is the correct structure is to calculate the formal charge on the atoms in each one of the remaining choices. So let's do that. Let's look at C. Let's look at this one, the one that we just drew, which is our first guess, and calculate the formal charge on each atom. So we remember that formal charge is equal to the number of valence electrons that the atom brings minus the non-bonding electrons plus one half of the bonding electrons. Okay, so this is a one half right here. Let me draw that just a little bit tighter so it doesn't encroach on our structure. Okay, VE is equal to valence electrons, NBE is equal to non-bonding electrons, and BE is equal to bonding electrons. So we have to calculate the formal charge on each individual element. So let's number our fluorine since we have three of them. This would be fluorine one, this would be fluorine two, this would be fluorine three. It's kind of hard to do that with this pen. Make them blue. Okay, so fluorine 1, fluorine 2, and fluorine 3. In the meantime, I'm going to clean up the little dots so they're more. Okay, can't erase that dot for some reason. Okay, so for fluorine 1, the formal charge is going to be equal to the number of valence electrons. For valence electrons, every fluorine, fluorine on the periodic table has 7 valence electrons. The number of non-bonding electrons that fluorine has is 2, 4, 6 non-bonding electrons, so 6. And the number of electrons that fluorine has in bonds for the first one is 2, because it shares 2 electrons between the first fluorine and the nitrogen. So when we do the math here, we get 7 minus 7, and that equals to 0. When we do the same thing on all of the remaining fluorines, they end up having formal charges of 0. So we know that our preferred structure should have a formal charge of 0 on all atoms. So that's how we do the calculation, and I'm not going to go through the calculation for the next structure D. I'm going to just assign the formal charges based on this strategy of calculating it. So this fluorine has a formal charge of 0. This nitrogen has a formal charge of negative 1. This fluorine has a formal charge of positive 1, and this fluorine has a formal charge of 0. So we don't want any more formal charge than we absolutely must have. So this one will be the preferred structure, C. Okay, this is just a periodic table in case I need one. All right, which is the correct Lewis structure for CO3 2- for the carbonate anion? Okay, so if we were to write down the number of atoms that we have and the valence electrons that each of them have. Carbon, we have one of those. It has four valence electrons, or is in group four. So we have 1 × 4 = 4. Oxygen, we have three of those. It's in group 6, so it has 6 valence electrons. And so 6 × 3 = 18. And then we see that the charge on the Lewis structure, on the compound, the molecule, is -2. So therefore, we have to add 2 electrons. So we end up with a total of 24 electrons that we have to work with. Now we need to draw ourselves a skeleton structure. We put the least electronegative atom in the middle. So our skeleton structure would look like this, and we used up a total of 6 electrons in making that skeleton structure, 2 for each bond. So now we have 18 electrons that we have that we need to finish distributing around the molecule. So that's 18. And now we need to check and determine whether all of our atoms have a complete octet and are satisfied. All of the oxygens have a total of 8 electrons. 2, 4, 6, and 8 here. 2, 4, 6, and 8 here. 2, 4, 6, and 8 here. But that's not the case for carbon. Carbon only has 6 electrons. It is not octet happy. It would like to have a complete octet. So now what we need to do is move a pair of electrons from one of the oxygens to form a double bond between the oxygen and the carbon. And when we do that, we end up with a structure that looks like this. Okay, so now when we go and check, we see that we've got a total of 2, 4, 6, 8 electrons around the oxygen, a total of 2, 4, 6, 8 electrons around this oxygen, a total of 2, 4, 6, 8 electrons around the carbon, and a total of 2, 4, 6, 8 electrons around the oxygen. So therefore, all of the atoms in the structure are octet happy, or have a complete octet. And the one thing that we have to remember to do is to put the overall 2- charge on the compound. So when we look at this, we see that we have this carbon double bonded to an oxygen, but the location of carbon relative to that oxygen is identical to its location relative to the other two oxygens. So this would be a condition where, a time where we have to consider drawing resonance structures, where we have the carbon being able to be bonded to the other two oxygen positions as well. I'm writing a little bit big. Let's see if I can do this a little bit. So we just rotate the place where we put the double bond. We just put it on one of the resonance structures, the double bond is here. On the second resonance structure, the double bond is here. And on the third resonance structure, the double bond is here. And remember, they're all equivalent structures. So therefore, the correct answer for this one would be B. Okay, so this one wants us to determine the formal charge of nitrogen in this structure. So remember, formal charge is equal to the number of valence electrons minus the number of non-bonding electrons plus 1/2 of the bonding electrons. So for nitrogen, nitrogen is in group 5 on the periodic table, so it has 5 valence electrons. The non-bonding electrons around it, we don't have any at all. Oops. Bonding electrons, we've got 2 here in this bond, 2 here, and 4 here. So 2, 4, 6, 8. We've got 8 bonding electrons. So therefore, we've got 5 minus 4, which is 1. So nitrogen, in this case, is going to have a formal charge of positive 1. A Lewis structure for the acetate ion is shown here. Which is the best resonance structure for the acetate ion? Okay, so let's look at our choices. First of all, to be a resonance structure, the atoms have to have the same bonding connectivity. So we have a carbon with 3 hydrogens bonded to it, which is next bonded to a carbon, which is bonded to 2 oxygens. So in this first structure, carbon is bonded to 1 oxygen, but it's not bonded to this oxygen. So therefore, this is not a resonance structure for that. Okay, so in the next structure, carbon here has a total of 10 electrons around it. And carbon is not one of those atoms that we talked about the other day, one of those elements that can form an expanded octet, because it's not in group 3 or higher. So therefore, this is not a plausible structure, because carbon can't have more than 8 electrons around it. In this structure here, number C, this is not the same bonding arrangement as the acetate ion here. The carbon here is bonded to an oxygen, where you don't see this carbon bonded to any oxygens. So therefore, that doesn't make sense as a structure. So our only choice that we have that's actually plausible, that makes sense, is this one, where we have the same bonding arrangement, where this last carbon here is bonded to two oxygens. So, and as you can see, the double bond just changed in position. So that would make sense as a resonance structure. It has the same bonding arrangement, but the double bond just changed in position. Okay. So it wants us to use a formal charge now to choose the best Lewis structure for this compound. when we look at the structures, in some of them we will see that sulfur has more than 8 electrons around it. And based on our last class, we saw that sulfur is one of those elements that is in group row 3 or higher on the periodic table. So therefore, it is able to have expanded octet or have more than 8 electrons around it. So I'm not going to do each one of these individually. I'm going to once again give the formula for formal charge. Formal charge is equal to the number of valence electrons minus the number of non-bonding electrons plus 1/2 of the number of bonding electrons on each and every atom. So I'm going to do it. I'm going to write what the formal charge is for each one of these, and then we're going to come back and determine the best structure. Okay, so I've written the formal charge on the atoms that actually have formal charge. If I didn't write a number next to the atom, that means that its formal charge is 0. Our problem asks us to use a formal charge to choose the best Lewis structure. But when you look at a couple of these, you can automatically see from the beginning that these are not reasonable structures, because let's look at structure A. For this structure, carbon has 10 electrons around it, and so does oxygen. And these are not elements that allow for expanded octets. Remember, in Thursday's class, we saw that the elements that allow for expanded octets are in rows 3 or higher on the periodic table. So therefore, this doesn't make sense off the bat. And in addition to that, when we look at our formal charges, we have a negative 2 on the oxygen, a positive 1 on the sulfur, and a negative 1 on the carbon. And we know in a neutral atom, we see that in a neutral molecule, this whole molecule doesn't have a charge on it. So therefore, the formal charges should all add up to 0. And they do not in this case. So therefore, for several different reasons, this is a incorrect Lewis structure. One is that it has the incorrect number of electrons around the carbon and the oxygen atoms. The second one is that there are formal charges, and we would prefer to have 0 formal charges on as many of the atoms as possible. And the third is the formal charges do not add up to 0, since this is a neutral molecule. We want them to add up to 0, and they don't. So this one we can rule out. Structure B, when we calculate the formal charges using our equation for each one of these atoms, they all end up being 0. So that would be a very good structure. So that's still on our list of contenders. Looking at structure C, the oxygen has a negative 1 formal charge, and the sulfur here has a positive 1 formal charge. They have an appropriate number of electrons around each one. And when we add up the formal charges, the overall charge is equal to 0. So that's a plausible structure, but we would prefer for all of our atoms to have a 0 formal charge. So when we compare this one and the last one, this one is not as good as the last one, because it actually has atoms that possess formal charge, and we would prefer not to have that. Looking at the last one, once again, this one is bad for many, many different reasons. Looking at the number of electrons around the carbon, we have more than 8, which means that this is not a good structure and not a correct structure. However, when you add the formal charges up, they do equal to 0, which is the charge of the neutral atom. But we have a large degree of formal charge. We have a formal charge on the, we have a formal charge on the oxygen. We have a formal charge on the carbon, and we have a formal charge on the sulfur, and we would prefer not to have that. So that is an implausible, a less plausible structure than this one. So B would be our correct answer. It's just another periodic in their case. I needed it. Okay, use bond energies to determine the delta H of reaction between ethanol and hydrogen chloride. So we haven't completely completed this topic yet. We introduced what bond energies are, but we haven't shown you how to do the calculation for the bond energies in a reaction. So we'll come back and finish this tutorial on this one after I do that. Finish that topic in class. All right. And so, answers. All right. So I also chose a couple of problems at the back of the book, just to do some practice on. And I'm going to go through a couple of the letters, in each of these. I'm not going to necessarily do all of them, but number 38. Is this one, and so it asks us to write a Lewis symbol for each atom or ion, and so I'm going to be writing big because the pen that I use, it doesn't draw dots well, but this is just if we need to go all the way back to Lewis structures. All right, so for sulfur, we know that in order to write a Lewis symbol, we look at the group in the periodic table where the element resides. Sulfur is in group 6, so it has 6 valence electrons, and then we see that it has a charge of -2, so that means that sulfur has a total of 8 electrons around it. So the Lewis symbol that we would write for sulfur would have 8 electrons around it. And we have to show that it's negatively charged. So we need to put a 2 minus or a -2 on the outside or near it. Okay, so how about magnesium? Magnesium is in group 2 on the periodic table. Magnesium has 2 valence electrons. And so we would just put those 2 electrons around magnesium like so. And remember, when we're putting electrons around our elements, we consider it as a four-sided box, and we can't start pairing up our electrons until we have an electron on each side of that imaginary box. Okay, so just keep that in mind. All right, so magnesium with 2 valence electrons, this is the Lewis structure. So what about magnesium 2 plus cation? Okay, so magnesium 2 plus, we start out with 2 valence electrons the same way as magnesium. It's in group 2 in the periodic table, so it has 2 valence electrons. And then when we account for that positive 2 charge, that means that when we, this pen is getting out of control. Hold on a sec. Let me see if I can rewrite that. All right. When we have a 2 plus charge, then that means we have to subtract 2 electrons. So therefore, we end up with 0 electrons that we need to put around the outside of the Lewis, for the Lewis structure of magnesium. So therefore, the Lewis structure of magnesium would just simply look like that, and then we would have our 2 plus or plus 2 charge on the outside. All right, so
The next one asks us to use the symbols, the Lewis symbols, to determine the formula for the compound that we expect to form between each pair of elements. Okay, so let's start with strontium and selenium. Strontium is in group 2 in the periodic table, and it has 2 valence electrons. Selenium is in group 6, and it has 6 valence electrons. So we would write the Lewis structure for strontium by placing 2 electrons around it. Okay, knowing that these are a metal and a non-metal, the Lewis symbol would be for an ionic bond that we write for the compound. So selenium has 6 valence electrons, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So we would then expect to transfer both of our valence electrons from strontium to selenium. Okay, selenium actually has 2 vacant positions that are available where we can transfer those electrons to. So therefore, we only need 1 strontium for every 1 selenium. So therefore, when we write the Lewis symbol, we write strontium. When we move those 2 electrons, we ended up with a 2 plus. And now we have selenium. When we move these 2 electrons, we ended up with a complete octet of 8 electrons. And the addition of those 2 additional electrons gave us an overall charge of 2 minus. So that would be the ionic formula, the Lewis symbol to represent the ionic formula for strontium selenide, or the bond that forms between these 2 elements. Okay, let's do one more. Let's do sodium and let's do aluminum oxygen. Okay, let's see if I can find my eraser. It's not going to erase. Okay, so let's do aluminum and oxygen. Aluminum is in group 3 on the periodic table, so it has 3 valence electrons. Oxygen is in group 6, so it has 6 valence electrons. When we look at it, is a metal and a non-metal. So therefore, we know we're going to have an ionic bond. So aluminum has a Lewis structure that looks like that. Okay, so oxygen has a Lewis structure. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That looks like that. Okay, so in order to make an ionic bond, we would need to transfer our valence electrons from aluminum to oxygen. Okay, but there are only 2 locations on each oxygen that are available to accept these 2 electrons. And we've got an extra one here that has to go somewhere else. Okay, remember we're trying to get an overall neutral charge on the molecule. So let's draw another oxygen down here too. Okay, we got another couple oxygens drawn, and let's draw. Okay, so if we were to now transfer this electron that we have circled in green to this oxygen here, then that would take care of all of the electrons for aluminum. But now oxygen still has a space that can hold additional electrons. So what we're going to end up doing now is sharing the electrons of two aluminums with the electrons of three oxygens. Because now, if you see that we've got one space on this oxygen, we've got two spaces on this one. So that's a total of three empty spaces where we can put an electron. So if we draw another aluminum with three valence electrons, we can now go ahead and put each one of those electrons on an oxygen. So therefore, we end up with two aluminums and each one of those aluminums gave up three electrons. So therefore, two aluminum plus three. And then we have three oxygens. And each one of those oxygens ended up with a complete octet. And in order to do that, they accepted two electrons from the aluminums. And so therefore, they each end up with the charge of negative 2. Now this goes back to your Chem 1. Remember, your overall molecule must be neutral. So if we got two aluminums and each one has a positive 3 charge, then that gives us a positive charge of plus 6. And we've got three oxygen, and each has an overall negative charge of minus 2. So that means we have a negative charge of negative 6. So therefore, our overall charge is 0. So that's what the Lewis structure would look like for the aluminum and oxygen. Now I know doing this on a video might not make it as clear as crystal clear as it needs to be. So please, if you still need additional help with this, make sure that you come by and let me know. Let's talk about it and I can try to make it a little bit more clearer for you one-on-one. Okay, once again, we have a lattice energies trend. We haven't covered that yet. We'll come back. Once again, another lattice. So sulfur, we have the skeleton structure, sulfur bonded to two fluorines. Okay, so we have one sulfur atom. It brings 6 valence electrons. We have two fluorine atoms. It has 7 valence electrons. So there's a total of 14. When you add those two together, you get 20. We used 4 electrons to connect our structure. So we have 16 electrons that we need to put around the remaining atoms. That's 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16. That one was very, very straightforward. Let me see if there's any on the Okay, so now let's do part C. Okay, so it tells us the order that the elements are, that the atoms are connected together. It tells us that we have the oxygen, both of the oxygens are bonded to the carbon. And so in organic molecule, we know that you can pretty much follow the ordering of the letters to determine our bonding connectivity, what atoms are bonded to each other. So our question told us that both of these oxygens are bonded to the carbon. So that's our first structure that we can play with here. It's our first skeleton structure. All right, so we have one carbon, four valence electrons. We have two oxygens, six valence electrons each. And we have two hydrogens, and they each have one valence electron. So there's 18 total electrons in this molecule. So we've used 8 of them already in connecting the skeleton structure. So we've got 10 electrons remaining that we can use to put around the rest of the atoms. So we've got 2, 4, 6, 8, 10. Oops, I wasn't supposed to pair that one up until, okay. So now let's look at this molecule. We've used our 10 electrons, 2, 4, 6, 8, 10 that remained, and we put them around the remaining atoms, and we see that all of our elements, all of our atoms are happy except for oxygen. So our first inclination would be to take this electron pair and try to move it to form a double bond. But we see that when we would, if we were to attempt to do that, we see that we would have too many bonds around carbon then. So therefore, the only way for us to make oxygen happy is to reconsider the connectivity of this structure. So we've got to see if we can connect the atoms in a different arrangement in order to satisfy the octet rule for every atom and to make the best Lewis structure. So let's go to a different assignment here. So this time, let's try a different structural arrangement where we still have both of the oxygens bonded to a carbon. But this time, let's see what would happen if we would bond a hydrogen to one of the oxygens. And so we still have the same number of electrons. We still had 18 electrons total. And we've still, once again, we've used up 8 of those electrons in our bonds, and we've got 10 electrons to distribute. So let's try this again. So we have 2, 4, 6, 8, 10. Okay, so now both of the oxygens are happy because they have an octet, which means they have a total of 8 electrons around each one. But carbon is not happy. The hydrogens are happy because they both have 2 electrons. But this is a more reasonable structure to start with, because now we could very easily take one of the pairs of electrons off of the oxygen and move it to make a double bond and make it where the carbon has 8 electrons and the oxygen. So let's do that. Let's take a pair of electrons and move it to make it a shared pair and form a double bond here. Okay. So therefore, we would end up with a structure that looks like this. So now let's check in with all of the atoms and see what their status is. Hydrogen, each one of them has 2 electrons around it. They're both happy. The carbon has a total of 8 electrons, so it's happy. The oxygen has 2, 4, 6, 8 electrons around it, so it's happy. This one also has 8 electrons around it, so it's happy. So this would be the correct Lewis structure for that molecule. Okay, so next one asks us to draw the Lewis structure for bromine fluoride, and it asks us to also draw an arrow to represent the dipole moment and the percent ionic character. These are the 2 things that we're going to discuss on Tuesday. So I'll come back with an example of that problem once I've introduced you to the concept. We'll come back and do this one. Okay, I'm going to do a couple of these. I'm going to choose 2. I'm going to choose N2H2, or letter A, and letter C. I'm going to choose just these 2. Actually, I'll choose letter A and letter B. Let's just do these 2. So, write the Lewis structure for each molecule or ion. So the first thing we need to do, of course, is to draw the skeleton structure. We'll figure out the connectivity. We know that hydrogens are going to be on the end because hydrogens do not like to form more than one bond. They don't like to bond to more than one thing, and they do not participate in double bonds. So therefore, our skeleton structure would look like that. And so we have 2 nitrogens. Each has 5 valence electrons, for a total of 10 electrons. We have 2 hydrogens. Each one has 1 valence electron for a total of 2. So that's 12 total electrons that we have to go around in the molecule. We've used 6 of them in the formation of our bonds. So now we've got 6 electrons to distribute around the remaining atoms. We know hydrogen doesn't want any more. They only want 2 electrons, and they're completely satisfied at this point. So now we need to put them around the nitrogens. So we've got 2, 4, 6, and that's all of the electrons we've got left to spare. So looking at each atom, hydrogen is happy. This nitrogen is happy. It has its 8 electrons around it. This nitrogen is not. It only has 2, 4, 6 electrons around it, and this hydrogen is happy. So the way that we would help the other nitrogen to get a complete octet or get 8 electrons around it would be to move one of the electron pairs off of that nitrogen that I just circled and have it to share with the other nitrogen. And so when it does that, it will form a double bond. And now when we look back, hydrogen has 2, it's happy. Nitrogen has 2, 4, 6, 8, it's happy. And this nitrogen has 2, 4, 6, 8, it's happy. And this hydrogen is happy. So that will be the correct structure for letter A. So how about the correct structure for letter B? Okay. So let's now draw that skeleton.
hydrogen always wants to be the terminal atom. So therefore, we would get something like that. The two nitrogens bonded together. The two hydrogens on each nitrogen. In our skeleton structure, we've got two nitrogens, each having five electrons. We've got four hydrogens, each having one electron. We've got a skeleton structure here that has 2, 4, 6, 8, 10. We've used 10 of our electrons already, drawn the skeleton. So now we only have four more remaining electrons to put around the rest of the atoms. So the hydrogens are already happy. They don't want any more electrons. So we're going to put the remaining electrons around the nitrogens. And so now let's check our structure and see if it is happy. So 2, 4, 6, 8 around this nitrogen, it's happy. 2, 4, 6, 8 around this nitrogen is happy. So that is our Lewis structure for letter B. And you can work C and D in the exact same way. All right. Write a Lewis structure that obeys the octet rule for each ion. Include resonance structures as necessary, and assign formal charges to each atom. So let's do letter A. Okay. So we've got a chlorine. And three oxygens. Chlorine does not like to be in the middle. It's very, very electronegative, so it always likes to be on as a terminal atom, remember? So therefore, we would probably have a structure that has three of our oxygens looking like that, and the chlorine sticking off to the side. But let's see if that makes sense before we can say with certainty that that's our final structure. So we have three oxygens. Each oxygen brings six electrons, so that's 18. We have one chlorine. Each one chlorine brings seven. So that's a total of seven electrons. The whole molecule has a charge of negative one, so that gives us an additional electron. So therefore, we've got 26 total electrons around to distribute in the molecule. So we've got six that we've used up already, so that leaves 20 remaining. So let's go 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16, 18, 20. When we look at each one, they're all happy. Chlorine's got 8, oxygen's got 8, oxygen's got 8, and oxygen's got 8. So now let's assign the formal charges. Okay, for chlorine, I'm going to do it the short way in my head, but we still are going to be using the same equation that we showed you in the one of the previous problems of and in class for doing formal charge, which is number of valence electrons minus the sum of the non-bonding electrons plus half of the bonding electrons. Okay, so for chlorine, it has seven valence electrons. It has six non-bonding electrons and one half of the total bonding electrons. So that's two there. So one half of two would be one. So therefore, 7 minus 7 is equal to 0. For oxygen 1, we have that oxygen brings in 6 valence electrons in this structure. It has 2 non-bonding electrons. It shares 2, 4, 6 electrons in bonds. Which is 3. Just going to go ahead and write 3 there. I can't get it to erase. Okay, so let me go back. Okay, so 6 minus 2 plus 3. So 6 minus 5 is equal to 1. Okay, the first oxygen has a formal charge of plus 1. That's not sounding good because our oxygens don't like to have a plus 1 charge. So this might not be the best structure. So the oxygen has a formal charge of plus 1 in this case. So what about oxygen number 2? Let's go look at that one. So oxygen has 6 valence electrons that it brings in. In oxygen 2, it has 6 non-bonding electrons plus... Okay, 1/2 of the number of electrons it shares in bonds, which is 2. So 6 plus 2 here. Sorry, 6 plus 1. So 6 minus 7 is equal to a negative 1 formal charge. Okay. So that's a lot of formal charge. We don't like for our atoms to have formal charge. Okay, that means that they look differently when they are in the molecule in terms of the number of electrons that are around them than they do as free atoms. So let's look at, before we determine whether or not we're going to draw a different structure, let's look at the last one, O3. Okay, so this last oxygen, it has 6 valence electrons minus 6 non-bonding electrons plus 1/2 of the 2 electrons that it shares in bonds. So once again, we've got a case where we have 6 minus 7, which is equal to negative 1. So this oxygen is negative 1 as well. We don't like that very much, okay? Because although the overall charge on this molecule is negative 1, when we add up negative 1 plus a positive 1, that's 0, plus another negative 1, that's negative 1. So the total overall charge on the molecule is the same as the sum of the formal charges, but we don't like for our molecules to have a lot of atoms that have a formal charge. So let's look at a different possible structure for this molecule. Okay, so let's look at this as a possible connectivity of the molecule of the atoms. What if we connect it like that? Okay, so we still have 26 total electrons. We now have, well, we still have 6 electrons that we've used up in the bonds. That gives us 20 electrons to distribute. So now let's do the most electronegative first. 2, 4, 6, 8. 10, 12, 14, 16, 18, 20. Okay, Well, that looks like a reasonable structure. So now let's look at the formal charges on each atom for that structure. Okay, chlorine comes in with 7 valence electrons, has 6 non-bonding electrons, and 1/2 of the 2 electrons that it shares is 1. So chlorine has a total formal charge of 0. Now oxygen 1 has 6 valence electrons. It has 4 non-bonding electrons, and it has 4 electrons that it's sharing in bonds, so 1/2 of that is 2. So therefore, this total formal charge on the first oxygen is 0. Okay, now the second oxygen, oxygen 2, it brings in a total of 6 valence electrons. It has 4 electrons that are non-bonding. 1/2 of its total electrons that's shared in bonds, it shares 4. So 1/2 of that is 2. So the total overall formal charge on this oxygen is 0. So this is looking like a much better structure. We expect one of these atoms to have a charge on it because the charge on the overall molecule is -1. But we like for the smallest number of atoms as possible to have a formal charge on it. So now let's look at that third oxygen. Okay, so we got 6 valence electrons again. This time we have 6 electrons that are non-bonding electrons. And this time there's only 1 shared pair. So that's 2 electrons in shared pairs, and 1/2 of that is 1. So we've got 6 minus 7 here, which is -1 for the formal charge on that oxygen. So the overall total of the formal charge is equal to the charge of the molecule, which is what we want. And we have the lowest number possible of atoms that have a formal charge on them. So this is the preferred structure for that compound. Okay. This one asks us to use the formal charge to determine which Lewis structure is better. Okay, so let's write down what the formal charges are on each element, on each atom. Hydrogen's formal charge is 0. When we do the calculation, this hydrogen is 0. This carbon, it brings in 4 electrons. We've got 2, 4, 6, 8 divided by 2. So we've got... just do your formal charge calculation and you'll end up with the formal charge on the carbon of 0. When we do the formal charge on the sulfur, we also end up with a formal charge of 0. This hydrogen has a formal charge of 0. This one does as well. When we do the formal charge calculation on this sulfur, it ends up with a formal charge of +2. And this one ends up with a formal charge of -2. So when you add these two together, you get 0, which is the total overall charge of the molecule. But when we are choosing the best structure, we would prefer for the fewest number of atoms as possible to have a formal charge. We'd like for most of our atoms to have a 0 formal charge. So therefore, this would be the best structure. Okay, so these are... examples of the last topics that we covered in class where the Lewis structure does not follow the octet rule. And we said we have three different scenarios where we have that rule can be broken. One is if we have a molecule that has an odd number of electrons. The other is if we have a molecule that contains a boron, a beryllium, or a lithium. And the fourth one is if we have a molecule that contains an element that's in group row 3 or higher in the periodic table. So the first one is an odd number of electrons. The second one is contains boron, beryllium, or lithium. It means it can have less than. And the third one is if it is in row 3 or higher. It can contain more than 8 electrons around it. So these next few examples are going to be those that are based on that latest rule. So now let's take the first one. Trichloride. All right, so we're going to draw ourselves a skeleton structure. The chlorines are more electronegative, so they're going to want to go on the terminal ends. Okay, and so now we need to calculate the number of electrons that we have to go around. So we got one boron. Okay, boron has three valence electrons. So that's a total of 3 electrons. Chlorine, there's 3 of them, and each one has a total of 7 valence electrons. So that's 21. So that's 24 total electrons. There's no charge on the molecule. So we have 6 electrons that we've used up in connecting the structure and the bonds. So that means we're going to subtract 6. So there's a total of 18 remaining electrons to go around. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. We don't start putting them on the boron until we finish putting them on the chlorines, because the chlorines are more electronegative, so we put them on the more electronegative first. So that's 12 total, 14, 16, 18. So that's all of the electrons that we have available. They're all used up. So now let's look and make sure, look at how many electrons we have around each atom. Around the chlorine, we have 8. Around this chlorine, we also have 8. And around this chlorine, we have 8. But around the boron, we only have 6. If this were any other atom, any other element, then we would be in trouble. But because this is boron, we said that if it contains boron, beryllium, or lithium, then and it is an exception to the rule, and we are allowed to have less than 8 electrons in its around it. So therefore, this is the correct structure for this molecule because it is an exception to the octet rule. Okay, let's look at the next one, which is NO2. Nitrogen dioxide.
All right, so we put our skeleton, our first skeleton structure together like that, and let's go see what we end up with. We have one nitrogen with five electrons, valence electrons. We have two oxygens, each has six valence electrons. That's a total of 12. So that's 17 total electrons to hold the structure together. So we've used four electrons already in putting the structure together in the bonds. So now we end up with 13 electrons to put around the rest of the atoms. So what is it about 13 that draws our attention? Well, we just said is one of our rules where we have an exception to the octet rule, because 13 is an odd number. So if we have an odd number of electrons, then we're going to end up with a one of the atoms, one or more of the atoms, that violate the octet rule, which means that they are not going to have a total of 8 electrons around it. So let's put these 13 electrons that we do have around our atoms. Let's start on the outer perimeter, the more electronegative one. So okay, we have the least electronegative element in the center when we did our skeleton structure. So we have 2, 6, 12. Now we only have one more electron to put somewhere. Okay, so we look at our atoms now. Oxygen is happy. This oxygen is happy, but this nitrogen is very unhappy. It only has 5 electrons. Now we are, because it's an electron, odd electron species, we are allowed to have less than 8, but we do need to get as close to 8 as possible. So therefore, we need to take one of these electron pairs and move it to form ourselves a double bond. And when we do that, we'll end up with a new structure that looks like this. Okay, so now let's check for our octet. Okay, let's see. All right, so oxygen, it's happy. It's got its 8 electrons. 2, 4, 6, 8. This oxygen is also happy. It's got its 8 electrons. 2, 4, 6, 8. Nitrogen has 2, 4, 6, 7, which is as happy as it could possibly be at this point, because it is an odd electron species. And so therefore, it is perfectly correct to leave this structure as is. But there's one more thing that we have to consider here. Look at how those atoms are connected together. The way that they're connected together, we've got the same arrangement, the same bonding arrangement for nitrogen connected to the oxygen. So we can have a resonance structure here where we could have the double bond on the other side. So we would end up with a resonance structure for this compound that will look, let me get a better, that will look like that. You need to have both of those structures in your answer to represent the correct Lewis structure. Now let's look at the final one, which is BH3, borane trihydride. Boron trihydride. All right. So in doing so, we know our hydrogens are going to be on the outsides. Okay, so now boron, we have one of those, has three valence electrons for a total of three total electrons. Hydrogen, there's three of those, they each have one valence electron. So that's a total of three. And when you add three and three together, you get six. There's no charge on the species. So now we need to go and find out how many electrons we've already used up in bonds. We have two, four, six that we've used up in bonds already because we have three bonds. And so therefore, we don't have any more electrons to distribute. So this has to be our final Lewis structure. So let's look at each atom. The hydrogens have two electrons. They're happy. The boron only has six electrons, but because boron is one of those elements that is allowed to have an incomplete octet or less than eight electrons around it, this is the correct structure. Okay, so write Lewis structures for each molecule or ion and use expanded octets as necessary. So this tells us that we're using that last rule from the other day, which is if it's in period three or higher, then it can have an expanded octet. So let's take a look. All right, first looking at phosphorus pentafluoride. Phosphorus of the two atoms, phosphorus is the least electronegative, so we're going to put that in the middle. So that means we've got in our skeleton, we're going to have five fluorines connected to it. Okay, so now let's go and see. Phosphorus, we have one of those. It has five valence electrons, so that means we have five total electrons from phosphorus. For fluorine, we have five of those, and there's seven valence electrons, so that means that 5 times 7 is 35. So therefore, we have 40 electrons to distribute in the molecule. So when we look at the number of electrons that we've used up already in our bonds, we have five of them with two electrons each. So therefore, we have a total of 10 electrons that we've already used up. And so now we have 30 electrons that we need to put around the remaining atoms. Okay, so 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16, 18, 20, 22, 24, 26, 28, 30. Okay, so that used up all of our 30 electrons. So now let's go and look at each atom. The fluorine atom is supposed to have eight electrons around it, and it does. It's happy. So does each of the remaining fluorine atoms. All of these have eight electrons, so they all have satisfied the octet rule. Phosphorus, on the other hand, has 2, 4, 6, 8, 10 electrons around it, not eight. But since phosphorus is in row three or higher in the periodic table, then that means that it can have what's called an expanded octet and have more than eight electrons around it. And therefore, this is a correct structure for phosphorus pentafluoride. So let's look at triiodide ion. So there's really only one way this could be put together, right? You got three iodines. Okay, and this whole molecule has a charge of -1 on it. And so now let's look at the total number of electrons that we have available. So iodine, we have three of those. Each one has 7 valence electrons. So that's a total of 21 electrons. Then we have to count this charge, this negative charge here. So that brings in an additional electron. So that is 22 electrons that we have to distribute. We've used up 4 electrons in putting our structure together. So therefore we have 18 remaining electrons to put around each atom. Well, to put around the atoms. That's 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16. Well, you've got 2 more that we got to put there, 18. So the reason that we're able to do this is that iodine is in row 3 or higher, and it is capable of having an expanded octet. So therefore, we can put the additional electron pair on the iodine, which ends up giving us a total of 2, 4, 6, 8, 10 total electrons around the iodine. I'm going to clean them up a little bit to where they look. I'm going to redraw it to where they look a little bit cleaner. Okay. So that's our expanded octet for iodine. For each of the following, for the remainder of these two practice problems for letter C and letter D, their sulfur is going to be your central ion. I'm sorry, your central atom. And the fluorines are going to be around. So you're going to have an expanded octet. And the sulfur atom is capable of participating in an expanded octet. And your germanium in the other one is going to be the one that has the expanded octet. So you can get some practice on those too. Okay, I think I've already done these for you, but let's just quickly go and do them. Okay. All right, so that's our skeleton structure. We've got 2 carbons, each having 4 valence electrons, for a total of 8 electrons. We've got 4 hydrogens, each having 1 valence electron, for a total of 4. That's 12. And so now we need to subtract the electrons we use in building the structure. So that's 2, 4, 6, 8, 10. So we've got 2 electrons remaining that we can put around an atom. So if we put them around that carbon and we go back and check, our hydrogens are all happy. They have 2 electrons, so they're satisfied. This carbon has its 8 electrons total, so it's happy. But this one only has 6, so therefore it's not satisfied. So we need to remove this pair of electrons here. form a double bond, and that'll give us that structure. Hydrogens are still happy. 2, 4, 6, 8 around this carbon. This carbon has 2, 4, 6, 8. Everything is happy. I want to show you another one where we form a triple bond, just to make sure we're happy, we're good with forming triple bonds. So what do we have? C2H2. This is a separate problem, separate practice. So let's put our skeleton structure together. We come in with 2 carbons, each having 4, 8 total. We have 2 hydrogens, each having 1, 2 total, 10 electrons. We've used 6 in the structure. That means we have 4 left that we can put around. 1, 2, 3, 4. And so now we see that our hydrogens are happy. This carbon is happy, but this one is not. So we need to move a pair of electrons to the middle here. And when we do that, we're going to end up with this structure. And now when we look at it, our hydrogens are still happy. This carbon is happy, but this carbon still doesn't have the required 8 electrons around it. So therefore, we're going to have to move this second pair of electrons, and we're going to end up forming a triple bond. Between those two elements, those two atoms. So this would be our correct structure here. All right, so. Okay, so that's it for thus for what we've covered so far in chapter 9. When we finish the chapter on Tuesday, we'll come back and complete the problems that we didn't do that still have not been covered in class yet.